This Torah class is brought to you by TorahAnytime.com.
Thank you so much, Rabbi Bacon, for the warm introduction. Thank you, everyone, for coming tonight. It's an honor and a privilege to be in this very chashuv makom Torah. And as Rabbi Bacon mentioned, we're within a week of Rosh Hashanah, and we begin to feel the Emas Hadin. We begin to feel the awe-inspiring effect that this great day has on our soul, where we say, ready or not, here we come. Whether we've prepared, whether we've spent the last few weeks gearing up for this great day, but even if not, we, so to speak, we sense, we begin to perceive the reverence and the sanctity of the Yom HaDin. I'd like to share with you a very incisive question. This question comes from a rare sefer. The name of the sefer is Emek Yehoshua, a Rabbi Zil Acharif. Rosh Hashanah, sometimes we get a little bit nervous. We certainly all take the day very seriously. Our tefillos take on an intense charge. And the question is, what are we getting so worked up about? The Gemara brings down an opinion in Masechta Rosh Hashanah, Rabbi Yosi, Adam Nidon B'chol Yoyim. Person is judged every day. Every day is Rosh Hashanah. I remember now, the Marsha mentions that the Gemara in Erevin has a Shaila, whether you make a Shechianu on Rosh Hashanah. And the Marsha wants to know, why wouldn't you make a Shechianu on Rosh Hashanah? And the Marsha says, because every day is Rosh Hashanah. So you're not going to say Shechianu. We're judged every day. Every day we have to do tshuva. What exactly is so significant about Rosh Hashanah if according to Rabbi Yosi, Adam Nidain B'chol Yom? Another interesting question. We know that Rosh Hashanah, although it's a Yom Tov, we don't say Hallel on Rosh Hashanah. The Gemara says, why don't we say Hallel on Rosh Hashanah? So the Gemara says, Sifrei Chayim v'Sifrei Meisim Suchim Lefanecha. The book of the living, the book of the dead are open. God is deciding our fate for the upcoming year. And you're going to say Hallel? That means the Gemara feels really you should say Hallel, but there's a p'tur, you can't do it. Ayin shalsachuvas hilchois katanois, simon ratio dalad. Where he asks, why should you say Hallel? Don't you need a miracle to say Hallel? Don't we only say Hallel when something supernatural happens? There's no miracle that we're commemorating on Rosh Hashanah. On Pesach, we say Hallel to commemorate a miracle. The miracle of the Exodus, the miracle of Yitzchak Mitzrayim. On Shavuos, we say Hallel. That's also a question. On Sukkot, we say Hallel. But what's the Havamina to say Hallel on Rosh Hashanah? There's no miracle that transpires on Rosh Hashanah. Ask the halachas ketanos. So I want to focus now on one expression that we say in the davening of Rosh Hashanah. We sort of take it for granted. It becomes part of the niggun. You know, we get so used to the high holiday tune that sometimes we forget to think about the meaning of the words. When I was a bachur, I had this chus. I grew up in Flatbush. I don't know if you know Brooklyn, Flatbush, on MN 31st. And when I came back from Eretz Yisrael, I had in my head, I have to go to Harav Avigdor Miller, Zecher Tzadik Livracha. So I used to walk from Avenue M and East 31st to Ocean Parkway and Avenue R, right next door to the Mir Yeshiva. And Rav Miller learnt in Slabotka. Remember, I have a notebook of questions I asked him. I remember asking him about what life was like in Slabotka. But one thing Rav Miller would say about Slabotka is that in Slabotka, here's the tune for the Mariv of Leil Rosh Hashanah. So we know, Ma'avir Yayim Umehei, right? Everybody basically has the same tune. Here's how it went in Slabotka. Umavir Yayim Umevi Loila. There was no tune. The tune they held takes away from the Kavana. Because then you're thinking about who composed that niggun, on what tape, what year. You're thinking about the person who composed it, not about the words. That's what they held in Slabotka. They did not sing in Slabodka. I don't know. I don't think that would really work today. But in Slabodka, they felt that a tune would sort of, distracts your mind from the intent of the word. So there's an expression that we say in the davening of Rosh Hashanah, which seems like a non sequitur, seems like a random expression, and that is we say as follows, Ki ata shoymea kol shofar. For you, Ribbono Shel, you hear the sound of the shofar. Umazin trua, and you're attentive to the trua. Ve'ein doimelach, and there's no one like you. Baruch ato Hashem shoymea. We stick in the phrase, Ve'ein doime lach. There's no one like you. No kidding. We know that already. What in the world does it have to do with the bracha of shofarais? Ki ato shomea kol shofar. You hear the sound of the shofar. Umazin shua. Ve'ein doime lach. You could inject Ve'ein doime lach in any given tefillah in the entire siddur. You open up the siddur, and I will randomly inject the words Ve'ein doime lach. Moida'ani lefanecha Ve'ein doime lach. Elokai neshamash nasatabi Ve'ein doime lach. Mizmor shir liyom ha-shabbos Ve'ein doime lach. Ein kelokeinu Ve'ein doime lach. You get the point. So why did the Anshei Knesset HaGdoila see to it to inject the words V'ein Doimelach specifically in the chasima of... No, there's a halachic principle that you need. Tzarech me'ein ha-chasima koidem ha-chasima. Meaning the penultimate part of the bracha, what the bracha ends off with right before the baruch has to be similar to what's after the baruch. So what does V'ein Doimelach have to do with Baruch Ato Hashem Shoimea Tshuas Amo Yisro Barachamim? Another question. There's a tour. The tour tells us that one would expect that on Erev Rosh Hashanah, we're so worried, we're so nervous, we have such anxiety that typically if somebody was being tried for a capital offense, the last thing they would do right before the court case was go to the barber, ask him to give you a nice haircut, go, have a nice shampoo, put on your finest clothing. Most people, if their life is on the line, they don't have time for personal hygiene, they don't have time for grooming, they don't have time to focus on the way they're presented, and yet Minog Yisrael Torah and the Halacha dictates that in preparation for Rosh Hashanah, we do take a haircut, we do groom, we do wear our finest. And the question the Torah asks is, this seems to be the opposite of what you would have expected us in our preparation for Rosh Hashanah. So the Torah says that we know the methodology of God, and we know that the Ribbono Shel Olam is looking to give us a good outcome. But let me read to you the words of the Torah. Avol Yisrael Einon Kein. We don't do what somebody would typically do in preparation for a capital case. Loivshim Levanim, we wear white. Umisatfim Levanim, we wrap ourselves in white. Umagalchen Zakanam, we trim the beard. Umachatchen Siparneim, we cut our nails. V'oichlin, v'shoysin, usmeichem. Listen to the Torah. L'fi sheyoidin, because we're confident and we know, shehakadosh baruch hu yase lohem nes, that God will perform a miracle for us. And since we know that God will perform a miracle for us, we're in somewhat of a happy mood. And the question is, what does the Torah mean that we're confident that God will make a miracle for us? What miracle does the Torah refer to? There ain't no miracles taking place on Rosh Hashanah. On Rosh Hashanah, every individual passes before God. God scrutinizes our actions, our thoughts, our inclinations, and He decides, l'chaim or l'maves. But there are no miracles taking place on Rosh Hashanah. What does the Torah mean we're confident that God will make a miracle for us? The Torah should just say, we're confident we're going to have a good year. There is a halacha in Shulchan Aruch, which so to speak, opens up for us a very important and basic and fundamental and revolutionary understanding of what is taking place on Rosh Hashanah. Shulchan Aruch Paskins in Siman Reish Chaf Hei, that if you have not seen your friend for 30 days, then upon seeing your friend for the first time, you make the following bracha. Shachiyanu v'kimanu v'higiyanu lazman hazeh. Baruch Hashem, we've made it to this day. I'm so happy you're still here. It's a great day. I didn't know where you were. I didn't know you're around, you're not around. Now, we don't really make this bracha anymore. There's so many forms of communication that if you don't see your friend in 30 days, you could assume nothing happened to them. Because if something would have happened to them, you would have found out about it within nanoseconds. The halacha continues. And what if you didn't see your friend in 12 months? What if you bump into your best friend, your worst friend, an acquaintance, and you haven't seen them in 12 months? Says the Shulchan Aruch, you make the following bracha. Baruch Ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech HaOlam Mechaye HaMeisim. Blessed are you, God, that you brought the dead back to life. Why would we make this bracha? The guy didn't die and come back to life. You're just happy he's still alive, aren't you? He didn't go to the next world and return. He's still alive. Why would you make the bracha Mechaye HaMeisim? Says the Mishnah Berurah. The Mishnah Berurah quotes the Marsha that if 12 months passed, that means the Rosh Hashanah has passed. A Yom HaDin has passed. And if a Rosh Hashanah has passed, you are entitled and you should make the bracha Baruch Atah Hashem Mechaye HaMeisim. You know what we learn from this simple halacha? You know what we learn from this Mishnah Berurah? That we have a fundamental lack of understanding of what takes place on Rosh Hashanah. We like to think, we tend to think. You know what happens on Rosh Hashanah? We come into the shul, and we stand before God, and we say, Ribbono shel Olam, I am alive. Keep it that way. I have my seichel. I have my mind. I have my intelligence. Keep it that way. I have a few dollars in my pocket. Keep it that way. I have a good chavrusa. I have good friends. Life is pretty good. God, keep it that way. Or better yet, stay out of my business this year. Because I'm the muchzuk. I have the presumptive status that if I'm alive in Tavshinai and Tess, then all I need you to do is make sure that my status continues for Tavshin Pei. But that's a mistake. That's not what happens on Rosh Hashanah. What happens on Rosh Hashanah is that the lease is over. What happens on Rosh Hashanah is life has come to an end. What happens on Rosh Hashanah is whatever money we were supposed to have, we don't have it anymore. What happens on Rosh Hashanah is our family is no longer ours. Our friends are no longer ours. All the blessings, all the benefits, all of the things that we think we could count on are done and over. And we ask God not to keep us alive. We ask Him to bring us back to life. We ask God, don't keep my mind. I know I'm a pretty smart guy. Just leave me alone. Let my brain continue to function. No, Ribbono Shalom, give me a mind for Tav Shin Pei. I'm a pretty popular guy. I have a ton of friends. God, I have nobody. I'm all alone. I need friends this year. Could I have a mother and a father? Could I have siblings? We stand before the Ribbono Shalom like Mesim on Rosh Hashanah. We're not confident. We don't have anything in our bank. We have nothing in our back pocket. We ask God not to keep us alive. We ask Him for the miracle of Techias HaMesim. We ask Him to resurrect us, to resuscitate us, to revivify us. You know, there's an expression that whenever we encounter this expression in davening, and we find it in a couple of places, this expression has a very specific connotation. And that are these are the words, Umi Doy Melach. We say in the second brach of Shemoneh Esrei, Mi Chamoicha Baal Gevurois Umi Doy Melach. Melech meimisu mechaya. The words umi doy melech have a very targeted connotation. They refer to a very specific ability of Hashem. You know, Hashem has many wondrous abilities. I like to say over, you know, you have a baby in utero, you have a child in utero. Child in utero doesn't breathe. The lungs are not functioning. Now, in a person who is born, so how do you get oxygen in your blood? So the blood is in one side of the heart. The heart then pumps the blood up to the lungs. The lungs take in the oxygen. Now that the blood is enriched with oxygen, the lungs send the blood back to the heart. And that's how we breathe. But a child in utero, its lungs are not functioning. Its oxygen comes through the umbilical cord. So then you'll ask, so then it doesn't need to send the blood up to the lungs. That's right. A child in utero does not send the blood up to the lungs. There's actually a hole in a baby's heart, and the blood passes from one side of the heart to the other, obviating the need for the blood to go up to the lungs. How long could a person live with a hole in their heart? It would be impossible to exist for a second. So what does Hashem do? Miracle of miracles. The moment the baby is born, he cries. The lungs inhale. It creates a pressure cavity in the heart. And the heart seals up. Just like that. If it wouldn't happen, the baby would need immediate surgery. So the whole process of inhalation and circulation is reversed the moment of birth. It's pretty amazing how Hashem does that. Nah, that's nothing. That is not umi doy melach. There's only one miracle that we say about the Ribbono Shel'olam. Who is like you? That is the miracle of Tchiyas HaMeisim. Where the Gemara says in Gittin, you could have a body that drowned in the bottom of the sea. And the molecules were then dispersed to the seven corners of the universe. The day will come where the Ribbono Shel'olam will reconstitute all the molecules of this body and create and perform the greatest miracle in history. And that is the miracle of Tchiyas HaMeisim. About Tchiyas HaMeisim we say, Umi Doy Melach. Here's another example. Ein ke'arkecha, v'yein zulasecha. Efes boltecha, umi doy melach. What does umi doy melach refer to? V'yein doy melacha moishienu, l'schiyas hamesim. The expression umi doy melach has one specific connotation. God's ability to resurrect the dead. There's a Sefer Oz Yasher written by Rabbi Moshe Shiur, who quotes Rav Moshe Shapiro, that from this phrase, Umi Doy Melach, that is employed in the davening of Rosh Hashanah, we learn that we need to have a little bit of an attitude change when we stand before the Ribbono Shel Olam on Rosh Hashanah. We are not confident in anything. We don't feel like we have anything. We're not a muchzik on anything. We ask God not to keep us alive. We ask Him to perform the greatest miracle of all. And that is the miracle of Tchiyas HaMeisim. Says Rabbi Zalach Harif, Adam nidoin b'chol yom. Yes, the person is judged every day. But when God judges us every day, you know what He says? Yesterday you were alive. Yesterday you were smart. Yesterday you were popular. Yesterday you were successful. The onus is on me to change things. God has to come up with a good reason to change the status quo. That's Adam Nidoin B'chol Yom. You're entitled to go to sleep at night and say, you know what? The Ribbono Shel Olam will have to come up with a good reason to change things tomorrow. Huh. Not Rosh Hashanah. When you stand before Ribbono Shel Olam on Rosh Hashanah, the lease is up. Life is up. Your success is over. Everything you think you could count on, all your blessings, needs to be renegotiated. You're not a muchzuk. You're not a marikama. There's no chazaka, not midin din, midin chazaka, all the lumdus of chazaka. You could throw it out. Not Reb Shimon Shkab's hashkab, chazaka, nobody's chazaka. The Rebbeinu Shem has taken it away. You need to come up with a good argument to get it back. And there's a miracle that takes place on Rosh Hashanah. Says the halacha is ketanois. This is such a legitimate miracle. It's a miracle that is mechayev ahalel, if not for the fact that sifrei chayim and sifrei meisim suchim lefanecha. You know what the miracle is? The miracle of umidoy melach. The miracle of tchiyas hameisim. The miracle of resurrection. The miracle of tchiyas hameisim is the miracle that takes place on Rosh Hashanah. And that is the miracle about which the Torah says we are confident, to some extent, that the Rebbeinu Shem can and wants to perform this miracle for us. I'm remembering a very powerful comment of the Avudraham. The Avudraham is the classic commentary on the Siddur. The Avudraham wants to know, why is it that the main body of Shemoneh Esrei and the Yom Noraim keeps on beginning with the following word? V'chein tein pachtecha, v'chein tein ka v'chein, u'v'chein, u'v'chein. What does u'v'chein mean? What does u'v'chein mean? And similarly. Meaning, in other words, it means nothing. You don't need it to be there. It should just say, tein pachtecha, tein kavod. Why v'chein, u'v'chein, u'v'chein? Says Avudraham, the word u'v'chein, like every word in Shemoneh Esrei, is a borrowed word. You know what it's borrowed from? It's borrowed from Megillas Esther. U'v'chein, avoy el hamelech asher loy chadas. It's supposed to conjure up the image of in your mind of standing before a melech with your life on the line. That's why Anshei Knesset Gedolah incorporated the word Uvechein in the Shemoneh Esrei, because the image we have to view ourselves is not standing in front of the Rebbeinu Shem with all of our blessings and telling the Rebbeinu Shem, keep it that way. It's we're supposed to conjure up the image of standing before a king, not knowing what the outcome will be. I want to share with you a tradition that we have from the Altar of Slabodka. Altar of Slabodka, many consider like the fatherhead of the Olam HaYeshivos. So many yeshivas in America and in Eretz Yisrael are offshoots of the influence of the Altar of Slabodka. The Altar of Slabodka is brought in the following context. What's the halacha? If you forget Zachreinu L'chaim, you have to say over Shemoneh Esrei? No. If you forget Micha Moicha V'Rachamim, you have to say over Shemoneh Esrei? No. If you forget Uchsoiv L'chaim, you have to say over Shemoneh Esrei? No. Only Amelech HaKadosh. But that's the sheet of the Rosh. Tosfos argues. Tosfos says, you do have to say over Shemoneh Esrei. If you omit anything, you're Meshaneh Mimatbeya Shatavu Chachamim, you got to repeat the Shemoneh Esrei if you forget anything. You know, some people say, you know what, I remember Rav Miller used to put his keys by the Yalav Yavai. Why? So you don't forget it. Some people actually care if they say the Yalav Yavai or not. Oh, forget it, I'll just say it again. No, he would make sure to put a big item by the Yalav. So you say, okay, that's Yalav Yavai, but Zachreinu L'chaim, what's the big deal? Even if I omit, I don't have to go back. No, but Tosfos says you do have to go back. It's only B'dieved you don't have to go back. Tosfos paskins, you do go back. The Rosh paskins, you don't. Shulchan Aruch paskins like the Rosh. Rabbeinu Yoina comes, and Rabbeinu Yoina brings in the Chachmei Provencia. And Rabbeinu Yoina says the sages of France hold, listen to this, that ordinarily during the Aseret Yemei Tshuva, you don't go back if you forget the four insertions. But on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, you go back if you forget Zachrein Al-Chaim. And the question is why? Miman of Shach. Adar Ya Adarnisht. Either yes or no. If it's important, you should always go back. If it's not important, then you should never go back. Says the Altar of Slabodka, you saw it in the davening of the Yom Noraim. davening on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur has an elevated status. Normally, tefillah is what? Midrabanan, according to the Ramban. But we know the Ramban holds tefillah be'eis tzara is da'iraisa. Tefillah on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur has this halachic status of tefillah be'eis tzara. It's a tefillah when your life is in danger. It's a tefillah when your life is in peril. And therefore it has the status of tefillah be'eis tzara, and if you omit zachreinu l'chaim, chachmei provansia hold, you go back. We don't paskin that way, but the yusayit is true. The davening of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur is a different davening than the rest of the year. It's a charged davening. We're not davening to keep things the way they were. You can't count on anything. You don't have anything in the bank. Nothing is a b'chazaka. It has the status of tefillah be'eis tzara. Tefillah with one's life on the line. The event, which is the most thematic event for Rosh Hashanah, is the Akedah. Nearly everything we do is to remember Akedas Yitzchak. The laning on the second day of Rosh Hashanah, we read about Akedas Yitzchak. We blow the horn of a ram to remember Akedas Yitzchak. We do Tashlich by a river, the Mishnah Berurah says, to remember Akedas Yitzchak. We mention Akedas Yitzchak in Zechroinos. Akedah is the central theme of Rosh Hashanah. Ask 1,000 people, why in the world do we talk about the Akedah on Rosh Hashanah? Oh, I know, because the Akedah happened on Rosh Hashanah, right? It must be. Not really. Not everybody holds. Actually, most Midrashim say it did not happen on Rosh Hashanah. The Psikta Rabasi says, yes, the Akedah happened on Rosh Hashanah. But the Yalkut Ruveni and other Midrashim say it took place on Yom Kippur. So I ask you a question. According to the other Midrashim, do they hold that we talk about the Akedah all day long on Yom Kippur? No. We don't mention anything about the Akedah on Yom Kippur. The Medrash Rabbah, anybody know, according to Medrash Rabbah, when the Akedah took place? Took place on Pesach. Do we do anything on Pesach to remember the Akedah? Nothing. So don't tell me that the central theme of Rosh Hashanah is the Akedah because it happened on Rosh Hashanah. So then why do we talk about it all day? So the very beautiful thought from the Sefer Oz Yashir that there are many Midrashim according to many versions of the Medrash. According to the simple reading of Rashi, okay, what happened? Avram Avinu took Yitzchak to the Akedah. He wanted to shecht him. And the Malach came and said, don't touch him. So Avram Avinu found the aisle. And by the way, the Meiri writes, the whole concept of kaparos is zecher l'akedas Yitzchak. Because what did the Meiri even says, the original custom of kaparos was to do it with an aisle. Because Avraham said, let my shechita of the aisle be b'tmuras Yitzchak. Zeh Timurasi. So Kaparos is also to commemorate Akedas Yitzchak. According to many versions of the Medrash, though, the story was not as portrayed simply in the Psukim. Whether it's Pirkei de Rabbi Elazar or by the account of the Shibalei Haleket, many Midrashim say that when Yitzchak was at the Akedah and Avraham stretched out his arm, Parcha Nishmasa Yishol Yitzchak Avinu. Yitzchak's soul left his body. Yitzchak died. In fact, the Shibalei Haleket writes that Shmoneh Esrei is a historical account of the main events in world history. So that when Avraham Avinu was thrown into the fire at Or Kasdim, and he was saved from the fire, at that point in time, they enacted the blessing, Baruch Ata Hashem, Magen Avraham. And after Yitzchak died at the Akedah, and his soul was returned to him, Yitzchak Avinu said, Baruch Ato Hashem, Mechaye HaMeisim. The Akedah is not the theme of Rosh Hashanah because it happened on Rosh Hashanah. The Akedah is the theme of Rosh Hashanah because the theme of Rosh Hashanah is Tchias HaMeisim. Because what we're asking the Rabbeinu Shlom for is not to continue our status quo, but we're literally asking the Rabbeinu Shlom to bring us back to life, physically. You know, the Medrash says that on Rosh Hashanah we stand before the Rabbeinu Shlom spiritually as well, like Mesim b'Maaseinu. In fact, the phenomenon of Tchiyas HaMesim can be considered analogous to the process of tshuva. Because if somebody whose maasim are lacking, if somebody who has insufficient deeds is deemed a rasha, is deemed a mess, the Gemara says, Rishayim b'chayehem nikraim mesim. Says the Medrash, Elu hadoiroi shehim kemesim b'maaseyem. Uboim umispalilim lefanecha b'Rosh Hashanah v'atebore oisam beria chadosha. That we're not just considered mesim physically. We are spiritually deemed as mesim. And we ask the Rabbeinu Shlom, help us resurrect our souls. Help us have tchiyas hamesim on our neshamais. Says Reb Tzadok HaKohen, you ever wonder? Eliyahu HaNavi will usher in the era of Tchiyas HaMesim. But wait a second. I thought a Malach can't do two things. And Eliyahu HaNavi will usher in Beheshev Lev Avos Habanim, the era of Tshuva. So what's Eliyahu going to do? Is he going to revive the dead or is he going to help us do Tshuva? Says Reb Tzadok HaKohen, it's the same process. It's the same phenomenon. It's the same mechanics. The process of tshuva is no less than the process of tchiyas hamesim. Where sometimes we feel so bogged down, so sullied, so dirty. Sometimes we get into bad habits. Sometimes we do things we don't want anyone to know about. We would be so embarrassed if anybody knew. We're so embarrassed from ourselves. And we stand before the Rabbeinu Shlom and we say to ourselves, can I really turn the corner? Can I really change it? Can I really stop? It's like I'm dead. Sometimes a person feels so bogged down, they can't climb out of the rut and the hole that they got themselves in. Can I pull out of it? It seems so impossible to change habits of years, sometimes of a lifetime. Certain things in our lives, we say, you know what? Scratch that. You know, I'll change X, Y, and Z, but not that. In that, I'm like a mess. Who comes to teach the world about tshuva? Who's the Navi of tshuva? Who do we read about in the 11th hour? Who comes to the wicked city of Nineveh and says, even you could do tshuva? Yoina ben Amitai. Yoina. The Malbim identifies Yoina. You know who Yoina was? Yoina was the son of the woman who sustained Eliyahu HaNavi. Yoina was the boy who passed away and Eliyahu HaNavi brought back to life. One of the only figures mentioned in the whole Tanakh who had Tchiyas HaMesim. Says the Sefer Rozei de Yoina, only someone who experienced Tchiyas HaMesim firsthand could come and reveal to the world that the process of tshuva is a realistic opportunity. That yes, there is Tchiyas HaMesim physically and there's Tchiyas HaMesim spiritually. Just want to conclude. I just happened to see this afternoon a wondrous medrash in the Yalkut Shemayni. The Yalkut Shemayni says on the Parak in Tehillim, Parak Kuf Beis, Pana el Tfilas Ha'arar. Yalkut Shemayni says that in our times, we're bereft. Think about what we don't have, the Yalkut says. The Yalkut says, Loi Kohen, no Kohen Gadol. V'loi Navi, we have no prophets. V'loi Beis HaMikdash, you know, all the good stuff, we don't have. We're down and out. Nothing supernatural. No way to feel the presence of Hashem. We have no Kohen Gadol, no prophet, and no temple. We only have one thing, says the Medrash. Listen to what we still have. V'lo nishtayra ela hatfilos she'anu mispalalim b'Rosh Hashanah v'yom HaKippurim. Ayam v'nayra. We don't have a Beis HaMikdash. We don't have a prophet. We don't have a Kohen Gadol. But we could still access the supernatural resurrection of Tchias HaMesim that's available when we stand the Shemoneh Esrei Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur. That's the only thing we still have left in the end of Tav Shinai and Tes, 2,000 years in Galus. We have the Amidah of Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur. But that's a powerful tool. With this tool, the Torah writes, we are confident that there is a nest that the Ribbono Shel Olam will still perform for us. And that is the nest that we allude to in the few words that Anshei Knesset HaGdolah have inserted in the bracha of Shofaros, V'yein Doy Melech Ribbono Shel Olam, there's no one like you. That even though right now I'm not slotted in for anything in Tav Shin Pei, you could change it up for the better. Right now I stand before you, Ribbono Shel Olam, so lacking, so deficient, with so many shortcomings, with so much to work on, with shame, with busha. How am I going to turn it around? V'yein doy melech, Ribbono Shel Olam, you'll give me siyata d'shmaya to do tshuva, where literally, Reb Tzadok HaKohen writes, the ability to do tshuva, the Ribbono Shel Olam will sprinkle on us the tal hatchia, the dew of tchias hamesim. Amazingly, Rabbi Yonatan Eibeshitz writes in the Yaros Tavash, in what bracha in Shemoneh Esrei should you be mechavein to do tshuva? That's an easy one. Hashiveinu avinu l'sar asacha. No. Ata gibar li'olam Hashem mechaye mesim ata. Tshuva is like one of those keys that the Ribbono Shel Olam maintains sole possession of. So too the Yerushalmi says, the Torah doesn't talk about tshuva. The Nevi'im can't tell us to do tshuva. The Chachamim don't know about tshuva. Only God. It's a key that is reserved for the Ribbono Shel Olam. So in the zuchus of our preparing ourselves for this wondrous opportunity, the opportunity to stand before the Ribbono Shel Olam on Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, because even though we don't have a Beis HaMikdash, we don't have a Navi, we don't have a Kohen Gadol, we could still stand in Amidah and effectuate the greatest miracle in the universe. May the Ribbono Shel Olam grant us all tremendous siyata d'shmaya, to be machzaras, the Seshuva Shleima, wishing everyone a year of bracha v'hatzlacha, shnas chayim v'shalom lanu l'chol Yisrael. Amen.
You've just experienced another Torah class brought to you by TorahAnytime.com.